the same woods that I do my daily vlog. But today's a special one, and this is going to go into my diabetes one. Today is 39 years of living with type 1 diabetes. You know, and it's been a different sort of passage. You know, 39 years, the biggest advance was the disposable needle. And now, you know, we progressed to where we are today. And, you know, a lot of diabetics lead a great normal life. You know, I've lived through infections. I've become a brittle diabetic. But, you know, it's all still good. Now, no matter what people are saying, you know, there may be cures out there for type 2, but we really haven't got a solid cure. The only cure we've had is for beta cells, and those can only be used for some people. Because of my size and such, I haven't had the chance to do that. But when the stem cell part of it comes, who knows? I would love to go and, you know, eat what I want to eat and have what I want to have. Now, you know, I hate to say it, but the biggest advance was counting carbs. And, you know, did we want to do it? You know, back then I thought, oh, it's just another way. But it freed us up. You know, back when I started, you could only eat what was on the list. It was the exchange list. And you had this kind of green book. And I think, you know, back then, there was matzah, and I didn't even know what matzah was, but it was free. So I always said I want to eat a whole bunch of matzah crackers. And back then they considered peanut butter as a fad. Then they turned to choices. And they all came out with pretty pictures, and, you know, that's when companies got on the bandwagon and would print a whole bunch of information for diabetics on the side, choices, and, you know, if you have one serving of this, it's equal to these many choices. And, you know, they decided the biggest thing for diabetics that affect blood sugar control was starch or carbohydrates. So that's how the counting process came. And you know, it allowed the diabetic more freedom. You know, type 1, if you want that piece of cake, you can have that piece of cake. Just make sure you know how many carbs are in it. And a lot of times, you know, people will look at you funny at restaurants when you ask, well, how much carbs are in this? And the only way things are going to change is if we ask. You know, and we go so often and we take a look at a meal and we say, oh, well, I know how many carbs that is, and we really guesstimate. But you know, in the large restaurants, when they plan these meals, They do look at how much carbs and that. They do know. It's just the staff at that store probably don't know. But, you know, we've got to get out there and ask. Because, you know, guessing could get you into a lot of trouble as well. So, being a diabetic type 1, we've seen many changes. I had one of the first glucometers on Vancouver Island, and it was a big chunky thing, and you had to, I don't know, wait 20 seconds or a minute, then you had to wash it off and then blot it off and then put it in the machine for an answer. And you know, back then we had a completely different way of measuring. You know, it was the same units as they used in the States. But of course, Canada went metric. And that seemed to change everything. You know, it was interesting. All the blood glucose companies started having their 1-800 number, and a pump had a 1-800 number that you would call if you have a problem. And I can remember, I think it was my, back then it was Ames, but it was my glucometer having an issue. And one of the questions was, well, what was your blood sugar? And I think it was something like 4.2. So I said 4.2, and you know, she said, well, you really should go have something to eat, you know, and you're in danger of passing out. Well, maybe a little bit higher, but still. And then I finally said, well, we're from Canada, and we have a different measurement. Oh, and you know, you could see like a light went on. But nowadays, every company has a Canadian counterpart, or they know what you're talking about when you say you have a blood sugar at a certain level. But we'll see what happens. You know, there's research going on at every level. I can remember telling my dad, oh well, yeah, the research was just around the corner. They'll come up with a cure. And you know what? They found a cure for type 2. It's pretty well exercise and lose the excess weight, and your blood sugars will fall into line. Well, that's because type 2 produces some insulin, not enough to allow the body to work efficiently. But once they lose some weight, things happen, and you know, oh, I cured myself of diabetes. Yes, but type 1 is very much an immune disorder. For some reason, our body attacked the pancreas. And once they figure out why, you know, us as a type 1 will probably find a cure. And you know, the cells are looking more and more as a chance to go. You know, having people saying that their diet is a secret diet that will cure diabetes. Well, my type of diabetes is 10% of the population. And you know what? I don't know when a cure comes. I'm so used to doing things, you know, the blood tests, the finger probes, the pumps, and everything. Who knows? Today, I'm living with a form of diabetes called Brittle. And people say, well, you know, if you just watch what you eat. Well, I've heard that from pretty much 3 years after having diabetes. And I've heard it all through my diabetes life. You know, if you just watch what you eat, and if you just stop cheating, you know, one day you can be fine, and the next day your blood sugars are all over the place. And it doesn't, I could be perfect, and you know, in 2014, I went into the hospital. And they tried many different things on me. And you know, I was pretty well put into a room and I couldn't go out. And it was a challenge. Well, they brought meals to me. I ate what was on there. I didn't eat anything else. This went on for 2 weeks. And they saw that I wasn't screwing around. But I would have these low blood sugars, Travis or Trevor or whatever yours was. You know, I'd sit down and go unconscious. Well, you know, some days I have great blood sugars and you know, you think, oh well, yeah, maybe this is the start. I can beat it. I can remember when I worked. I would, you know, break a class because I had to quickly go do a blood sugar. I do a blood sugar and, oh, it's good. And then by lunch, I had totally crashed. And this is only like 2 hours. But having brittle diabetes is a challenge. And you know, it's not what you eat. You know, you count carbs and, you know, and counting carbs doesn't mean that you get a piece of cake every single day for dinner. Counting carbs are realistic. You know, you have what you can have and you count the carbs. Sounds easy, doesn't it? And it is. But, you know, you can't have high sweet items all the time. I can remember, you know, I ended up in the hospital that my blood sugar was out of control. And, you know, my father kept saying, well, stop eating a Big Mac. Stop going eating Big Macs. You know, once in a blue moon was I going out and eating. You know, I tried following the diet. You know, I tried counting carbs. And, you know, when I was in Royal Columbian for 9 months, you know, it kept opening up challenges. So, we're finally getting on something that is working, and I'm not always heading back into the hospital. You know, I decided a long time ago, I'm not going to let diabetes define me. I may have awkward blood sugars, but you know what? That's who I am. I'm not going to be depressed about it because if you're depressed about it, diabetes wins. And there's no chance, you know, I have neuropathy. And that's why I'm pretty well in the chair. You know, there's some days, oh, my legs feel great. You know, I get up, I walk down the hall. You know, I try to get outside, and then one of my legs starts acting up, and it's really hard to walk back up. And then there's other days I sort of have to really fight to get into my chair. That's diabetic neuropathy. And you know, I have an awful lot of people who say, well, you know what? If you just watched your blood sugar, and if you just had it under control, you wouldn't be in this predicament. Well, I went in this predicament because I didn't watch myself. I'm in this predicament because my body decides to do something completely different each and every day with the food and the insulin I take in. But you know what? I don't let it get me down. You know, they say, well, we change this, and okay. And I move out, and not move out. But you know, I leave the clinic or the hospital, and I give it my all. But, you know, I have friends who we go out, and you know, they're always touching my head. Oh, are you sweating? Well, just to fool them, I don't sweat anymore. So, just take the best care that you can. Follow the guidelines. And do what you can with diabetes. Remember, diabetes is a condition. Someone asks you to talk about yourself. You know, that was an old thing on the courses I went to. And that was, well, tell me about yourself. And then, you know, they say, well, why do you say you're diabetic first off? And they said, at that point, I realized, you know what? I was letting diabetes describe me. And you know, looking back now, I don't let it decide me. I watch it, you know, and I send the graphs, and my pump does a lot of recording. You don't have to be so precise in your recording anymore. But you know, times have changed and the way we handle things. I watch the diabetes. I try to control the diabetes. I don't let the diabetes control me. Anyway, have a great day and happy diversity to me. Talk to you later. Bye.